In order for us to get out of Lucasville, we had to walk to catch a bus. Walk this whole length of Lucasville, go on the bus, do our work, then come back and walk home again. So we had it tough.
I grew up here in sort of a working farm.
I'm Mrs. Jesse Allison of Upper Hammonds Plains.
My grandfather, they tell me he was born back in the 1700s.
And we didn't have any bus at those times. We walked to school.
I don't see any more horse and wagon on the highways.
There was no cars at that time.
When my husband was digging up the ground, and he found all these bones.
Everything has changed from one day to another.
Well, most of the men, they made barrels, they coopered.
History, a chronological record of a branch of knowledge that records and explains past events. Histories of communities, villages, and towns are for some an elusive thing to come by. The history of Halifax, founded in 1749, has been well documented. Some smaller locations, such as Hammonds Plains, have had their local history written up in books by resident historians. But for smaller communities, such as Lucasville and Upper Hammonds Plains, finding information pertaining to periods and ways long gone is not an easy task. Many times in the past, and more so today, individuals have said, "I wish we had something that would tell us more about when the early settlers arrived here. Why and where did they come from?" So much is lost. In some small way, this video will help to tell a story that will, if nothing more, whet the appetite of those thirsting for information of one kind or another. The main aim of this program is to inform and maybe send you on a journey searching the past and welcoming the future with new optimism. The historic black community of Lucasville is located approximately 10 miles northwest of Nova Scotia's capital city, Halifax. Named after an early settler, James Lucas, it was first known as Lucas Settlement. The first land grants were handed out to Richard Wyman and to George Pike in February of 1764, and in September 1783, an additional grant was made to John George Pike, both residents of Halifax at the time. The date of these grants verifies that the community of Lucasville is indeed 234 years old.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved.
The Lucasville Baptist Cemetery was dedicated in November 1939, as the community was in need of a new burial site. The first graveyard used for the interment of the members of the community of Lucasville is located off the old Sackville Road, behind the Sackville United Baptist Church. The graves mainly being marked by a stone at the head and foot of each site. The graveyard was originally serviced by a cart road that ran alongside the south boundary of the present United Baptist Church Cemetery. This cart road has long been non-existent, And in fact, it is believed that a number of people have been buried in the road. And grace, my friend. Since the closing of the cart road, the new cemetery is located on the William Parsons Lane off the Lucasville Road, making this much more accessible to the community. With the headstones marking the graves of the cemetery, this was an interesting way of collecting many of the old family names, such as Lucas, Parsons, and Oliver, these being some of the original community settlers.
I do remember the story that my late husband told me of the first William Oliver. There have been four William Olivers, you know. Well, the very first William Oliver had been a slave, and he had been working for some big farmer. Of course, when they came here, they were free. And he was working for some very rich man that owned half of the old Sackville Road. And he thought himself, he was getting a salary, that he would like to put his money into land. And he was able, by going to the government at that time and talking about the large lot of land that he wanted, it was all woodland and whatnot, that they gave him the grant. That was the first William Oliver. And I think it was something like 100 acres grant that they gave him on the recommendation of the man that he was working for too. So he brought this land, and where all the Olivers are settled today on the cleared land, to say nothing of the land that's not cleared, it's the same land that the Olivers passed down from one Oliver to another. And really that could have been called almost Oliverville, because all of the homes at that end were, and probably still are, Olivers.
Oh, my father had a shop, yeah. Mm-hmm. He was Mick Hope's, Chumwood. Mm-hmm. And he used to take it to town.
He used to take the Kenleywood to town?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Horse and wagon. I used to go with him.
All right.
Joe Bennett, he lived across the street from me, and he used to carry the mail, and it was on Tuesdays and Fridays, and they took it to Rebecca Lucas's house, and people used to go there and pick up their mail.
My grandmother was Mrs. Rebecca Lucas, the one that kept the post office.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, and she would sit and watch everybody that went to church to make sure you didn't make any noise in church, you know. You had to be so quiet.
The love of God.
In the heart of every community, there is a need to build a foundation for worship, fellowship, comfort, celebration, and consoling. For the black community of Lucasville, this would be the Lucasville United Baptist Church. In 1839, a Baptist congregation was organized among the settlers in the community, with the first meeting house being erected at about 1874, which served the community until the present-day structure was built in 1964 by a local contractor of the day, Mr. Gordon Parsons, and several volunteers from the community. Since this time, many additions have been made to the structure, such as the educational wing, a ladies' parlor, and a baptismal pool. Today, the church still remains a focal part of the community, with the many organizations of the church holding special services, home visits, and church suppers. For the past 25 years, Reverend Dr. Donald Fairfax has been the pastor of the Lucasville United Baptist Church and has served the community faithfully.
Especially when you are facing the unknown in life. Trusting God, though you're not always sure where you're going or how you're going to get there. trust in God is so important. And then giving thanks when you realize you have reached your destination.
Good afternoon, church. Blessed is the man whom thou chosest and causest to approach unto thee, that he may dwell in thy courts. We shall be satisfied with the goodness of thy host, thy holy temple.
Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. And when he saw them, he said unto them, Go show yourselves unto the priest. And it came to pass that as they went, they were cleansed.
This church is dear to my heart and will always be dear to my heart. And I trust that as you continue to grow in God's grace, removing all the bitterness, having a forgiving spirit, God will change this church and do something that he wants to do instead of what we want to do for him.
Thank you. How thankful we should be that God has given us the Bible, his holy word. In it we find wonderful promises, guidance, conviction of the sin in our lives, forgiveness, comfort, wisdom, the answers for every question and need.
Yeah, no plows. They had to shovel over the road before we could get out.
Oh,
and in those years, the snow would be way up over us. We couldn't see anywhere. Mm-hmm. But now we don't get snow like that.
No. So they had two groups of men. One would start at one corner and one at the other corner?
Yeah, because we had to split the community in two, see. So then they'd all meet and we'd know, Betty then would know that all the men turned out to work.
Good day. Men had to work and shovel.
To get the
there was no cars at that time. Mm-hmm. So horse and sleigh.
The Lucas name should be first because the community is named. Maybe that was for Reverend Wallace Lucas. I'm not sure of that. You might know. But the Lucases must have been quite prominent to have the community named after them.
Yeah, they can help them, they can kill them wood and stuff like that. That's how they made a living. Yeah, I had a jack and everything out there, thing to make them with.
Okay.
Yeah, I have a thing out there to make them with. What, that's one time.
There was a special tool for making the hoop?
Yeah, yeah. Yarnage, one thing and another like that, and hatchet and stuff like that. And
I think the ladies did housework, most of them. Mm-hmm. And so that's what they did. They had a car come and pick them up and take them to the various jobs.
The women, when they were having their babies, they would have to have a midwife. Yeah.
So were most of the babies born at home?
Yeah.
Years ago?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so was there one special person in the community that
was? There was three midwives that I know of. There was my aunt, Mrs. Janet Kelsey, and another aunt, Mrs. Anna Oliver, and Mrs. Ethel Ford.
When I was going to school, they brought teachers in. Mm-hmm. Well, nobody didn't pick me up. Mm-hmm. I walked to school.
Was it quite a walk?
No, it was from the old home over across the road there, mm-hmm. and right back there where Eugene, back there.
Hi, my name is Linda Oliver, formerly Vandenberg. I've lived in Lucasville for my whole life. I grew up here in sort of a working farm family. There were a few others, but my father had a large farm. We had numerous animals, goats, pigs, chickens, cows, horses, pigeons, geese, a dog and a cat as usual. My mother worked outside of the home as a domestic. My father worked for the Red Cross building. He helped build the building, and then after that he got a job inside.
In June 1786, 504 Negro refugees were settled in Hammonds Plains. According to the book, Hammonds Plains, the First 100 Years, authored by Dorothy Pazanson Evans, the section known today as Upper Hammonds Plains was settled as a result of the War of 1812. The first black settlers to arrive in this area began to work the land. This group of residents was known as the Chesapeake Blacks, who were refugees enticed here by the colonials of the day from the Chesapeake Bay area in the United States. Despite many hardships in the early years, including what some describe as an outbreak of scarlet fever, and several families being shipped off to Trinidad, as well as the people not being prepared for the harsh winters they faced, the settlers of this community that remained were determined to make this their home.
I'm Mrs. Jessie Allison of Upper Hammonds Plains. I'm 94 years old, and my birthday was May the 8th, 1997, this year.
Mm-hmm. Well, I grew up right here in the community. Not too far from here. The homestead is just up there. And my father used to work at Pockwock at the mills. Mom, she was a housewife. She looked after us when we were bad. And we went to the school in Hammonds Plains. It was a little small school. And we didn't have any bus at those times. We walked to school.
Mrs. Madeline Stein was a teacher.
Granny Maddie, we called her. Mrs. George Simons was our teacher.
And she came here, and she assisted a young woman to be a teacher. And when she came, she wasn't Simons.
The younger kids would go in the afternoon, and the older kids would go in the morning. But I think they went by grades, like from grade primer up to grade four was in the afternoon, and then the older kids went in the morning, which were they were bigger.
Well, it's been a big change with our roads and everything being paved, and everybody with cars or trucks or whatever. Don't see any more horse and wagon on the highways. Nobody allowed to coast on the highways anymore. The children used to coast up and down the hill. I used to be able to coast from after school right up until dark, and we didn't mind walking up that hill. Now I don't want to walk up the hill for walks.
I've seen all these changes with the telephones and the lights and all of that connected with Hammonds Plains and the paved roads and all the things. I remember when we walked through these roads here, for some time it would be in the spring of the year, the mud would be to your knee pretty near. I'd be driving team with a load of barrels on going down the road, but I got the wheels of the old on the wagon would drop down, the horse couldn't move it. The horse down in the mud and the wagon down in the mud couldn't couldn't move, Mike. Yes, you had to take your load off and get the wagon out and then put the load back. Oh, boys. I'm telling you, them was some days back in there. And I see all these changes. Now we go down the roads and the car laying back.
Yeah.
I say, them days you didn't lay back in nothing.
And no. Another change was the garbage truck coming up, picking up the garbage from your gate. That's something new.
Yeah, that's all different now.
You don't have to go back in the woods with your garbage. Mm-hmm. You just put it on the tie it up, put it on the side of the road.
Everything is so new. Yeah, but there's a lot of things I see.
And the milkman come through. You don't have to go to the grocery store to put the card in the window, stop bringing the milk.
One time we had milk our cows. We had our cows and one thing in the road then, we did, but no pasture. You know, and these cows, we'd be running up and down the road and then and if a car come along, they didn't know nothing about no car. The car would be blowing the horn and they'd be hauling too.
Yeah.
Could have saved. I used to laugh.
Yeah.
I used to smile at these cattle, because cattle never hear that kind of a sound. And the cow, the car would blow the horn for them to go to the road. They wasn't moving. They mooing like that in the road in front of the car. And them.
But everybody helped everybody here.
Yeah.
So they would go out and all help cut down the hay for the fall.
And say so-and-so is going to be haying. This is what the phrase they use tomorrow. Well, I'm going over to help them, and then they'll come and help me. Mm-hmm. And this is how they did.
And if they were going to build a house or a barn, they always helped each other.
10 or 20 people would come, and the barn would be up in one day.
Emmanuel Baptist Church.
They go to church.
The church.
Our church. Going to church, you know. I got a spiritual life.
The Emmanuel Baptist Church, and then I'm a auxiliary member of Emmanuel Baptist, and I'm a choir member.
Everybody would get a ride to church.
Then I stopped praying church and started having church for Jesus.
Our church is, 153 years old, and it took many years before they got that church down the road. And the men used to go to the city, Dad said, the men used to go to the city overnight and bring back the lumber and stuff after, you know, to build a church.
Thank God I'm here in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name. Oh.
I don't know what you've done for. I don't know what.
Information taken from the book, Whatever Your Will, Lord, authored by Reverend Dr. W.P. Clayton, tells us that Father Richard Preston organized the Emmanuel Baptist Church in 1845. Even though the congregation was never a large one, the Emmanuel Baptist Church has been blessed with several men of the fellowship becoming ordained into the Christian ministry. Today, the church works closely with the community members to ensure the continued growth of the church and the community. Reverend Dr. Willard P. Clayton is currently the pastor of Emmanuel Baptist Church. As well, he is a local historian and instrumental in reviewing the history of the Emmanuel Baptist Church from 1845 to 1984.
You're doing
today, the people of this small community still stand up in church to testify as to the blessings the Lord has given them.
Always on time. Here is Pastor Clayton this morning to bring the message. I pray these blessings in your holy name. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord this morning. God's going to touch his people this morning. He's going to touch his church this morning with the Holy Spirit, and nothing will deter us or separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
The walls can fall down, the paint can peel off. Nothing, says Paul, nothing, neither life nor death will separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord.
Amen.
I want you Christian mothers and fathers to hear this morning, because you're going through a rough time.
Yes.
You're going through a troublesome time.
Yes.
You're going through a time when all society is against you.
Yes.
Your girls and boys are being used as gunfodder for the artillery of the devil himself.
Yes.
You need God this morning.
Amen. Amen.
Yes. You need God this morning.
Yes.
And let us be reminded.
And I would long, long persuade.
1969, members of Upper Hammonds Plains formed the Upper Hammonds Plains Community Cemetery Company. President Deacon Neil Anderson helped to bring this goal into reality. The purpose was to establish, maintain, conduct, manage, and operate a public cemetery for Upper Hammonds Plains. In securing this lot of land located on the Anderson Road, the residents now have easy access to this place of interment. The original cemetery is located behind the Emmanuel Baptist Church on the Pockwalk Road. In the late 18 and early 1900s, the settlement of Upper Hammonds Plains was a thriving, self-sufficient area, providing employment for residents both in as well as outside of the area. The several sawmills that operated, along with the cooper shops, farms, and the fish caught in the local lakes, made for an independent society. Today, one mill remains, along with many of the family names of the original settlers. The offspring of this group of survivors have continued to show the same spirit.
There was about 7 or 8 mills in this community, and they all made barrels and fish barrels and boxes and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And they hauled them into Halifax by wagon, and that's what we done there. And this place was self-employed, you know. So nobody would come work over this place. We had people come into this place to work with the people that were already here, but nobody ever went out to work on any other job, but there was labor here. I remember I growed up that way. I worked with my father and learned to trade from my people and how to make barrels and how to run the mill, even the mill that we operate today. We got it from way back there. Years ago, this business of ours is running over 125 years that my grandfather was in the mill business and was handed on to my father, and then it come down to me. And then I'm still operating. We've been operating here for 60 years or more.
Turn in the other, and then you can drive that together and it sticks together
and
right in one
piece. And that's how the boxes are made.
Yeah, that's the kind of boxes. And this is the cut-off saws. Cutting lumber all off the one end.
Oh, this is interesting. Just slides back and forth.
Yeah, that's right. You just put the lumber on there. And this is a hand hole. Maybe we're putting hand holes in the boxes. I'll just show you how that works. So that's run by part of this mill run by electricity, and a part of it is. When you put a piece of lumber so there on that rough side, mm-hmm. and then you come out and you go through there, it comes out just like that, smooth like
that.
Oh. Yeah. Mm. So you just put it through here and it'll come out on the other end. That's the way it's done.
several areas of concern that must be addressed in order for these communities to remain healthy and productive into the next millennium. First and foremost, the two communities must remain committed when it comes to supporting the development office, which has become an effective and significant part of both communities over the past 4 years. Secondly, shrinkage of community land or land owned by community residents due to the fact that prime property is being purchased by outside developers with little or no regard for the historic value of the community. The steady exodus of our young people from the community due to a lack of affordable housing and transportation has also become an issue. Social problems facing our communities, which include drug and alcohol abuse, must be mentioned. This problem is not limited to these two communities alone, so together the communities must work to help the young people gain the confidence needed to face life in today's society. And lastly, we could always use more funding for the social programs and community initiatives, such as the many educational programs being offered in Lucasville and Upper Hammonds Plains.
The remote learning center is small one-on-one adult learning facility, so it provides the extra care and tender loving care, I guess, they need to achieve their end goal, because if you're an adult learner, you tend to be a little bit defensive and very low self-esteem. So apart from teaching academics, you have to build them up too, so that they become more confident and more articulate, so they can at least express their feelings and share information. So it's a nice place.
Our program particularly is aimed at the Black learner. Having it set within the Black community, first off, aids comfort. They're among their peers. There's more of a commonality amongst the students. We can have a curriculum which includes Black history and an Afrocentric curriculum. As well, again, the transportation issue. In a lot of Black and Native communities, they're on the outskirts and therefore a little bit isolated. So having them in the community not only aids their comfort level, but it also is very important in terms of access.
In our education committee, it's roughly around 21 people, with parents and also members of the different schools that I mentioned already. In this exciting year, we're able to give scholarships to high school students. Scholarships fund was set up. I must say we got funds from our church and also from the Community Development Association to start us on our way. Also this year, the committee itself will be having a benefit dinner to raise funds. We have this year in the program Shira Jackson, which you will talk to later. She's one of the coordinators for the program, and Shirlene Sims is the other ones. We're not trying to do anything to invent anything new. We're just trying to help our kids the best way. And with them, is help, you know, with them coming, they will help us help them even more.
At first with the tutoring program, like some of the children did not want to attend the tutoring program. And then after that, after we've seen them come down, then after that they enjoyed the tutoring program, they have learned, and we have also noticed, like in some of our children, how they have, like their study skills have changed, their attitude towards learning. Even some of the teachers have seen that they have also noticed some changes in the students since they have started the tutoring program, that they seem to be more focused on the work. And so in that there is a great help. At least we know that we are doing something right.
I was introduced to the program my first year here. And so I was really happy to participate as far as our involvement at the school level to try to support the program, the good work that was going here with the volunteers. And that support was generally through providing some materials. If we had leftover books, if we had books that were not being used in the class, we would supply whatever we had extra to the center to help in different areas of reading or math. And then in addition to just supplying some materials, we also have a program where our staff participate on the voluntary level each week by, you know, making a schedule up and coming out whenever they can to be here and to be you know, seen by the students themselves as supportive. And I think that's very important, because when children see you here, you know, in person, they know and feel that the program is important. Their own teacher is there, or their own principal comes out, you know. And so this is really important to me to have our staff volunteer in that way.
In May 1966, when members of Upper Hammonds Plains decided there was a need to form a fire department within the community, the Upper Hammonds Plains Volunteer Fire Department was founded. The fire department was incorporated on June 25, 1976, and is recognized as the first all-black fire department in Canada. In 1981, an extension was added to the fire hall, which consisted of two bays, an office, a meeting room, kitchen and washroom facilities. The fire department also has one pumper truck, two tankers, and a van.
Let's join the parade.
Today, the fire department has a membership of 18, with 13 honorary members. Two of the 18 members are female. The following is a list of men who served as fire chiefs for the Upper Hammonds Plains Fire Department. The late George Marsman, 1966 to 1967. Wesley Anderson, 1968 to 1975. Clarence Oliver, 1976. Wesley Anderson, 1977 to 1979. Paul Williams, 1980. Maurice Allison, 1980 to 1992. And Wendell David, 1992 to present. The community spirit of sharing and caring is still alive today in Upper Hammonds Plains, as evident in the building of a new home for Mrs. Joyce Simons, with Deacon Neil Anderson taking on the task of organizing this tremendous project.
This last new home that you mentioned, it was something.
Deacon Neil Anderson said to me that I should get a house built, and I said, no way, I'm going to move to an apartment. He said, no, it's a shame to move, you know, leave your home, leave the country and go to an apartment.
And she says to me, she say, Deacon Neil, she say, where the money coming from?
But I can't afford a new house, that's for sure.
I don't know. I say, the Lord will provide, and he opened the way for us.
I don't know what he did.
And I called the council in one day, and I spoke to him, and I say, Mr. Council, we got to help this lady.
I don't know what he did.
He said, do you approach the municipality or the county or whosoever for money? And I said, everybody refused me. And he looked at me, he said, where do you go from here? And I said, between the Lord and you and I, we will have this woman a house.
But he did a lot of things. Anyhow, it was June the 23rd, I'll never forget, because the same morning my daughter passed away. He came that morning and said to me, they're coming this morning to dig your foundation. That was June 23rd. And, I said, fine, but I wasn't in the mood for that at that time. You know, I didn't want to even worry about that. Then they came and they dug the foundation, and this happened. And then the long connection. Next thing was the cement trucks, and everything was moving and moving, and he was calling his people, and a lot of people helped me out very well with this house. I could never have done it by myself.
And the 24th of December, the house was completed, and she moved in on that date. So I feel really proud.
Although, I mean, it's put me in quite a bit of debt, but it's worth it. It's worth, you know, worth the debt.
The Lord carried us right through from the time we start right to the end. And we're going to get stuck in the middle, but he never let us get stuck.
Yes, it's quite a difference moving from the big city of Toronto to Upper Hammonds Plains, but I've always liked the country when I lived in Toronto, and I relished the opportunities to go out into the country there, so I was quite happy moving to the country here.
Formed in January 1976, the Malvern Land Tract Protection Society is a non-profit organization comprised of members of the community of Upper Hammonds Plains to use or receive the benefit of the land known as the Malvern Land Tract. The Malvern Land Tract is a 1,000-acre lot of land granted to the community of Upper Hammonds Plains by the Crown to use for future development of the community for such projects as forestry, recreation, and training programs.
The Melvin Tract Society also, whereas a lot of the harvest that has been done in years gone by, we are looking forward to developing a lot of that, such as planting trees. It could be used for a lot of different ways. And so time will tell. We have time on our side. And I'm pretty sure, as I said many times before, that the Melvin Land Tract Society is very important to the community of Upper Hammonds Plains.
It was basically a reforestry project for the property that the community owns here on the Melvin. It's called the Melvin Tract Land Society. And we had a consultant that taught the participants silviculture, aspects of trees, basically where they will grow properly, where they want swampy or wet areas, that sort of thing. And we were supposed to be planting, but we had a problem with the beetle bug this year. I would think that we would need a project that would last at least 5 years to rectify the problems that are out there on the property.
Within the historic black community of Upper Hammonds Plains, the Pockwock Lake and the most modern water treatment system in North America are located 22 miles north of Halifax. Formerly known as the Lucasville-Upper Hammonds Plains Development Office, the development office was set up in 1993 to facilitate the 5-year Community Economic Development Strategic Plan mandated by the communities of Lucasville and Upper Hammonds Plains. The development office is run by a staff of 7 and provides development and the coordination of programs, services, and or initiatives identified by the community residents. Staff are also responsible for the development of project funding for applications or proposals and presentations, preparing personal tax forms, government applications, and forms for residents and community advocacy. This office seeks to establish and maintain internal and external communication linkages with the residents, community organizations, and other community development stakeholders.
The community center hosts many functions. They host the tutoring program, the development office, the youth service program. The community center also hosts outside programs.
I am involved in many organizations here within the community. Chairperson of Lucasville Upper Hammonds Plains Development, which operates out of 2 communities, Lucasville and Hammonds Plains, and our coordinator is Reverend Darrell Gray.
Hello. And even through Focus Hope, that what we've been able to see through Focus Hope, that out of a vision can come a multitude of things. Simply out of a vision can come a multitude of opportunities. All right? But that we've got to focus on the needs, the individual need and the community need. And then we need to surpass that and we need to find out what is needed in the economy. What is it that is needed that we can produce? Not necessarily goods and services, but human resources. All right, talents and expertise.
That Lucasville, I feel, should start right down at the beginning of the highway and it should go right through to the Hammonds Plains Road. But you see, that's not the way it is. So that squeezes Lucasville into a very small, but the name is so nice.
We do have a lot of community support here.
The community of Lucasville, I really enjoy living here. I forget how many years I've been here now, but I enjoy living here. The people are wonderful. I never had a problem with anybody since I've been here. We really, if anybody is in need, or have a problem with in this community, everybody will get together and try and help them.
I'd like to say that this is a real nice, family-oriented place to live and bring your children up.
My life in Hammonds Plains, I had a good life here in Hammonds Plains.
I just wanted to say one thing about this community. It is one of the nicer communities. It really is, and this is not giving anybody any roses.
As we look back at our ancestors, we can only imagine what adversities they must have endured. Ever since their first footsteps onto this soil, they have carved and shaped what is now two prominent black communities in Nova Scotia. Lucasville and Upper Hammonds Plains started out from the wilderness and grew with every hardship, keeping the sense of family and trust in God. Eventually learning to work the land and becoming a self-sufficient, thriving people. The legacy of our forefathers is the determined, strong-willed, and proud of who we are and what we become. Today, as we go forward, using our own resources, welcoming change with an enthusiastic outlook, we also continue to shape and carve our futures while still growing from the seeds that were planted so long ago.
Washed in his blood. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long.
And then I took all my blankets from home.
Oh, yeah.
The qualifications needed to be successful in their academic careers.
I did it!
I got my hand here.
Take two. The song is called Amazing Grace. Amazing Grace.
Copy of that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Do you think George?
I'm just rolling a little footage here.
I don't even want to see it.
Well, it was nice talking to you, Mr. Rolls.
Yeah, but you have some bright gold stuff, but why is the light so bright?
So we can get a good picture of you on the camera.
I see.
That's it.
Okay.
I suppose.
Great.
I play by note, read music.
Hi, I'm Henry Bishop. This is Wayne Hamilton. This is January 24th, 1998. This is song one, take three.
You're the heck of the toy, you're a lot of things.
Oh.
Okay, you can stop. 1998. Play one.
But don't go any higher than the top four.
Okay.
All right? Russell's making me laugh.
Well, I'd like to thank you, Mrs. Wiley. Thank you so much. And Deacon Wiley, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, thank you so much.
Mr. Oh, I enjoyed it. I really enjoyed it.
And he's the minister.
He's the minister.
Yes,
that's right. Yes.
Well, thank you very much, Miles. It's been a pleasure talking
thank
to you.
Thank you.
I could go on. You want to know about me?
Man, it is dry in here. Today, the church still...
Okay.
See, you know what? I'm...
I know.
Because I didn't pause there.
Okay, let's pick it up.
Well, that dog is wild. If he wasn't any sooner, he would have jumped through the window at you.
Yeah,
and we'll just show this on the tubing program.
I went right back to the yard too. Are you?
George, he's trying to be really serious too.
George, you're too close.
Well, thank you very much, Brother Elwood, my husband. It's been a pleasure talking.
God bless you. Pleasure's been all mine. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much for talking with us, Deacon Anderson.
Thank you.
We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for your interview.
Thank you.
Oh, Lord, if I do this again, I'm going to cry. We've only done this, what, a half a dozen times?
No. Stop it, George.
George?
I think...
Yeah,
I think I do. I don't know at all. I don't think I do.
Do what you can do.
All right.
All set?
Yep.
And whenever you're ready.
Take one, the hem of his garment. Oh, there was a woman in the Bible days who have been sick, sick so very long.
Stop that. Thank you very much, David, and for your interview, and thank you, Yvonne, for your interview. It's been very pleasurable.
Well, thank you very much, Shirley. It was great talking to you, and a pleasure.
Have to shoot the producer.
Okay. Thank you so much.
You're very welcome, Deborah. Thank you for coming.
Thank you very much, Cheryl. It's great talking to you, and good luck in the future.
Thank you very much.
Well, we certainly appreciate you coming up, Mr. Jerwa, and thank you so much.
Yeah, and I just want to say one other thing. I really like the program that you're doing, because you know I'm a history buff here in terms of culture and what it means to people to, you know, to record what they're doing. And so I can, you know, right away identify with what this is all about. So thank you very much.
Yeah, you're right. I have to close it out, don't I? My Lord, I don't know what I'm thinking. Well, let me finish these, and then we'll sit down and write up a summary.